All right, good morning, everyone. I'm John Berman. We have live pictures from Capitol Hill, where Republican senators hope their breakfast this morning is better than their dinner last night, because that came with a side order of a complete collapse of the plan to repeal and replace Obamacare. Done, over, fini, at least for now. Doomed by the late-night defections of two more Republicans, that as the president was whining and dining other Republicans to win their support. In fact, the news came shortly after the president reportedly told senators they would look like dopes if they did not pass something. We're told the president was caught off guard and he was annoyed. Perhaps you can see that annoyance this morning in some of his new writings. He is pointing some fingers. He says, "We were let down by all of the Democrats and a few Republicans. Most Republicans were loyal, terrific, and work really hard. We will return," he says. This as the president is now calling on Republicans to just repeal Obamacare now, worry about replacing it later, an attitude now being adopted by the Senate Majority Leader. Quite a morning on day two of Made in America Week. MJ Lee has the very latest for us from Capitol Hill. Good morning, MJ.
Good morning, John. Well, what a dramatic night. Mitch McConnell getting not one, but two nails in the coffin last night on his Senate bill. Senators Jerry Moran and Mike Lee coming out at the same time to say that they will vote no on the motion to proceed. What this meant, of course, was that McConnell could not even bring up his bill to proceed on the Senate floor. And he basically acknowledged that repeal and replace is not going to be successful. Now, John, if that was plan A, now we are moving on to plan B. And here is plan B. McConnell wants to still move forward on the motion to proceed vote. And then if that is successful, he wants to bring up an amendment that would be a 2015 repeal bill that would repeal but delay that repeal for 2 years. That went through the Congress in 2015. However, it was vetoed by President Obama. Now, if the repeal and delay plan sounds familiar, it should, because this is a tactic that Senate Republicans and House Republicans considered at the beginning of this year. But then they decided that there was no appetite, even within the Republican conference, to just pursue repeal without a replacement plan ready. And remember, President Trump himself also said that repeal and replace should happen simultaneously. So there are a lot of questions right now as to whether McConnell can even get 50 votes to move forward on this new plan. I will say, though, some senators might be won over by this new plan. For example, Mike Lee, his aide, telling me this morning that he will now vote yes on the motion to proceed. Now, President Trump, of course, very frustrated. You can tell based on his tweets earlier this morning. He said, you read one of the tweets. The other tweet read, "As I've always said, let Obamacare fail and then come together and do a great health care plan. Stay tuned." Now, we are certainly staying tuned and watching especially closely the Senate lunches that will happen in a couple of hours. Inside this closed door meeting, we expect some senators to offer pushback to McConnell for his new plan, and we should be getting a little more clarity on what McConnell wants to do in terms of the timeline. He says that he wants to have a vote in the next couple of days. We'll see if that actually comes this week. Now, if we thought that last night was dramatic, we can certainly expect the next couple of days to be quite tumultuous, John.
Next couple of hours, quite tumultuous. MJ Lee for us on Capitol Hill, this healthier discussion, really the main event up there. But there is a bit of a sideshow with some implications here. House Republicans are about to unveil their new budget plan, and it might not be the salve that Republicans are looking for to soothe some of their divisions. CNN's Suzanne Melvo joins us live from Capitol Hill. What do we expect, Suzanne?
Amazing, John, when the budget becomes a sideshow here, but it is critically important. This is going to happen within an hour or so of House Speaker Paul Ryan and others unveiling this budget. And essentially, there has been an incredible amount of infighting between conservatives and moderates, the House Freedom Caucus members really pushing for much deeper cuts here. But also what is critical to know is that they're using a budget tool called reconciliation to allow them to push through tax reform with a simple majority on the Senate side. So that is why this is so critically important. But here are some of the numbers that we already know that will be revealed. What is in the budget here on the House side, $621 billion for defense spending, a real priority for this administration, $511 billion for non-defense funding spending. And then look to see what they are actually cutting. This is where the Freedom Caucus wants some severe cuts, less spending here, $203 billion when it comes to cuts in mandatory spending programs like Medicare and Social Security over the next 10 years. The conservative members want that number to be even double, so we'll see what that looks like. Is this going to pass? What is the likelihood of this? Well, we will see the budget committee tomorrow actually take this up, take a look at it. If it gets through the committee itself, it will go to the full House, but that is unclear, John, whether or not they really have the support. They might have to wait a little bit. It could be a terrible embarrassment if they don't get those numbers. And they would need Democrats, if they don't get this budget resolution, they would then need Democrats to actually pass through tax reform on the Senate side. John?
Yeah, and that hasn't been working out so well for them so far. Suzanne Melvo, thank you very, very much. Joining me to talk about the healthcare thunderclap overnight, Matt Lewis, CNN political commentator, senior columnist at The Daily Beast, Caitlin Huey Burns, a national political reporter for Real Clear Politics, and Lynn Sweet, Washington bureau chief at the Chicago Sun-Times. And Lynn, it was an astute political analyst who said the Republicans would look like dopes if they did not pass the bill to repeal and replace Obamacare. That analyst was President Donald Trump, who also said if the Republicans have the House, Senate, and the presidency and they can't pass the health care bill, they're going to look weak. So is the president right? Do Republicans this morning look like, in his words, weak dopes?
Well, dopes is, I'm not going to go into the loaded word of dopes, but John, clearly they have some explaining to do on why they couldn't get a strategy together to do the repeal and replace. And this repeal is there's a big catch to it. It won't be effective for 2 years at the least. Let's really keep an eye on when that effective date is, because it would get you past the midterm elections. In the midtime, it would let some of the lawmakers send out a press release saying we did something at least. Reason replace became part of repeal is that health care is a big deal to people, no matter what your ideology, your ethnicity, your religion, to have a pre-existing condition. All of a sudden, policy becomes very personal.
So, Caitlin, now, as Lynn was saying, they're going for repeal and delay, or repeal only, but it's a little bit loaded what the Senate Majority Leader is trying to do here. He wants to vote on a motion to proceed, and it's technical here, before they then vote on the full repeal. This is a tough vote for Republicans to take here, particularly some moderates, even moderates who voted for the full repeal in 2015. What are the pressures they face?
Exactly. So you have some of these that were opposed to the bill in the first place that are concerned about, you know, repealing something and replacing it with something that would leave people without insurance, that would perhaps cut into part of the Medicaid program, which is also an interesting discussion among Republicans. So the idea that if they couldn't go for the replacement plan, the idea that they're supporting a repeal plan without anything else to offer people, I think is a very tough vote. Meanwhile, you have the more conservative members of the Senate who are wanting a full repeal. And McConnell could be kind of putting pressure on all of them to say, look, let your vote known. If you are a conservative who's wanted full repeal, right, here is your chance to do it. And if they don't, that kind of puts them on the line here. But I think Trump also, the president also deserves, will get some of the blame, a lot of the blame here, because he is, had positioned himself as the deal maker. And you can argue about his ability during this whole process and the extent to which he let the Congress lead. But he said that he would get this done and didn't.
The golf tournament on Sunday. We'll talk about the president in just a moment. Matt Lewis, I want to say something now, because if I don't, I know you will. On January 25th, you wrote, the Affordable Care Act is a mess. By trying to replace it, it might just create a bigger one, and one that this time the people will blame on the Republicans. So after you take a bow for
predicting this on
January 25th.
Why make the big bucks?
What happened here? Was it the president playing golf instead of making deals? Was it the fact that it just would never happen with the competing divisions of the Republican Party?
Yeah, look, I think that this was basically doomed before it started for a variety of reasons. Once the public accepts the fact that that health care is an entitlement, that it is, you have a right to health insurance and health care, then the idea of having a truly free market approach doesn't work. And then it becomes, who can give us the most, right? So it's hard for a conservative to win against a liberal, or the Obamacare even, with who can give us the most. Fundamentally, once you get past that, Republicans never had a plan. The conservatives spent 7 or 8 years voting to repeal Obamacare, but never had a coherent idea on how to actually replace it. And Donald Trump, who actually did have somewhat of a nationalist ideology, just outsourced it to Republicans. So this isn't even something he is losing on, something that wasn't even a Trumpian policy to begin with. It is a complete mess and debacle. We are now in June, and Republicans have passed nothing of substance.
Yeah. And the worst part is we're in July.
That's even worse. When did that happen?
Yeah, I mean, seriously, it's so bad. It's so bad it's not even June anymore. Lynn Sweet, you know, it's interesting because the president has said two things this morning. On the one hand, he has said that he wants Republicans to just repeal Obamacare now. On the other hand, he says, like he said all along, let Obamacare fail. So are failure and repeal two different things?
Yes, they are. And I want to go back to Caitlin's point. The art of the deal is making something happen. Just doing nothing, you don't need to be president to do nothing. Repealing may have the same aftershock effect of helping Obamacare to fail because you will destabilize the insurance markets. If the free market was the answer to all insurance, we wouldn't have needed Obamacare. If the free market was the answer to everything, you wouldn't have Medicare existing to insure seniors because the marketplace would have taken care of it. So repeal and maybe in this motion to proceed might let some lawmakers have a chance, by the way, to split their vote where they could have it both ways when it comes to campaign time, saying, well, I just voted for the motion to proceed.
Right.
We could have an up or down vote on repeal, but then I voted against repeal. That's a tactic we've seen used for a long time. But no, if you're looking for a stream of consistency in these tweets, you're looking in the wrong place.
Look, just to be clear, the CBO, the Congressional Budget Office, did score repeal only back in 2015, and they essentially said that in year one that 18 or 19 million people would lose that insurance, and 10 years out, there'd be more than 2024, depending on how you measure it, even more than that, people without insurance. So repeal only could come at a very high cost, a similar cost that had moderates concerned about this to begin with. Caitlin, I want to play a game I like to call, you know, what does this mean for? So, what does this mean for the president moving forward, do you think?
Well, for the president, you know, his argument this whole time, again, was that he was able to change the way that things were done in Washington, and Republicans at the same time were arguing, getting behind this president, arguing that once Republicans had full control of Washington, they would be able to get their agenda passed. To your point, it is now July, and Republicans are going to go home, presumably, next month at some point, we'll see, and without anything to kind of show for it. This task, beyond the healthcare component, was a task of governance, a way to show that this party could govern. And so I think it falls on both Republicans and the president that they weren't able to get this done. And what this bodes for legislation down the line, tax reform is really hard. It's, some argue that it's more difficult than Obamacare.
So Matt Lewis, one group that Caitlin left out there is Democrats. So what does this mean for Democrats? What lessons should they take from this? Why shouldn't they, from a purely political perspective, look at this and say, hey, everything we're not doing has worked?
First, I'll say a couple things. One, I think we're now entering into this repeal phase, right? Remember the sequester? People forget about this. The whole point of it, we got this sequester, which ended up actually lowering the deficit, right. But the only reason it happened was because Republicans and Democrats couldn't come together and pass something better. So the idea that you can play chicken, Republicans could do that and actually pass something in 2 years, I think is dubious. I think that there's a danger, of course, for Democrats to just sort of say, we're going to run against Donald Trump. I think you can do that in the midterms and win. Nancy Pelosi did that against George W. Bush. But if you don't, if you never have a coherent philosophy or policy, then you end up where Republicans are now. You're the dog who caught the car. So Democrats had better start developing a proactive and sort of, optimistic policies for America if they actually get in power.
Maybe, just maybe, Democrats and Republicans will work together and come up with some idea. Maybe we will see some horns. Matt Lewis, Caitlin Huey Burns, Lynn Sweet, great to have you here with us this morning. Thanks so much, guys. All right, calls mounting this morning for Jared Kushner to be stripped or lose or never get his security clearance. Sources tell CNN White House staffers are worried that this could happen. And two of his colleagues just killed the bill he helped put together. Republican Senator John Thune, a member of the Senate Republican leadership, joins us to tell us what's next. Plus, outrage builds over the shooting death of an unarmed woman in Minnesota. We're learning more about the police officer who shot her.